Ladies and gentlemen, it's To Tell the Truth. And here sitting in for Gary Moore is your host for today, Bill Collins.
Hi there. Thank you. Thank you all very kindly. Coming up there. Thank you. That's enough. Hang on. Oh, that's good. Hey, that's good. I'll tell you why. Thank you for whatever that was for me. But we got a lot of interesting people coming out, and save some for the other four little people on the show. They're a grand. Hi, I'm here keeping the seat warm for Gary Moore for a while. He's having some fun. We'll meet our first guest in just a moment. And he has, and listen to this, because there's a clue in here, cleverly contrived. The first man we're going to meet later on has a large mission in life. Oh, that's clever. Remember that. But first, let's meet our panel here on To Tell the Truth.
Derwin Kirby. Peggy Katz. Mark Goodson. And Jimmy Carlisle.
That's a beautiful panel, but it's not as pretty as when I was here. No, I say that.
I think you look very pretty there.
Thank you, Kitty. It's you. Durward, I'm happy to see you again, and I'm very pleased that you can be with us. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Bill. My pleasure, indeed.
It is.
Nice to see you.
Right.
I haven't grown since I saw you last.
You're still taller than I am, though.
Am I really?
Fortunately, you have a bad leg. But that's another story. I can't tell you, Peggy, how nice it is to see you.
I just saw you yesterday.
I know, but it's fun again to see you, Peggy. I mean that sincerely. I'm banking on you to pull me out of this, Peg.
Gee whiz.
And, Kitty, I can't tell you how nice it is to see you.
You seem to be stalling, dear boy.
No, I just want you to know it's real nice to see you. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you very much.
Right, okay, well, oh, hi, Mark.
Hello, Bill. Nice to be here, Bill.
Yeah, see, he knows he's talking to somebody with seniority in his outfit. If you're not careful, it's both of us back to winner take all.
That's right.
Panel, by way of introducing our first guest, now, this is my first time here, so naturally, they changed everything up. So, to meet our first guest, let's meet his wife. This is Mrs. Fabry, Joyce Fabry, right? That's Panel, P-A-N-E-L.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Panel as Miss Fabry. Now, Miss Fabry, if I may, well, let me see how I can put this. You've already put it so well yourself. As Orson Bean would say, you have been bountifully endowed by our creator, Mrs. Fabry. Would that by any chance have anything to do with his first spot?
Yes, it would.
It would?
Yes.
All right, we'll see how it comes out. Now, since Mrs. Fabry is here, I'm going to let her, you're in trouble, Johnny, I'm going to let her do Johnny Olson's job and introduce her husband to us. Miss Fabry, if you will, please.
Thank you, ma'am.
What is your name, please?
My name is Bill Fabry.
And what is your name, please?
My name is Bill Fabry.
And what is your name, please?
My name is Bill Fabry.
And thank you, Mrs. Fabry. You may go backstage now and watch the old man on the monitor, and we'll see you again in just a few minutes. Okay, panel, if you care to hear this, I will now read Bill Fabry's story. I, Bill Fabry, firmly and positively believe that fat can be beautiful. Throughout the United States, fat people are ridiculed, maligned, and misunderstood. In contrast, the pleasingly plump are appreciated, prized, and admired almost everywhere else, including Eastern Europe, all of the Arab countries, and in many islands of the South Seas. Here in America, the underfed twiggy look is publicized and promoted to such an extent that perfectly healthy women starve themselves into feverish conditions of jangled nerves and bad temper. In order to improve the sad lot of all beautiful fat people, I have founded a new organization called the National Association to Aid Fat Americans. Signed, Bill Fabry. You see what I meant before about a large mission in life?
All right.
Okay. Panel, this gives you an opportunity for food for thought. They're getting better. Well, we listen to a few messages. Okay, panel. Remember, these three gentlemen all claim to be Bill Fabry, founder of the National Association to Aid Fat Americans. And we'll start the questioning with Slim and lovely Peggy Cass.
Thank you. Number two, are you going to aid them to become thin or just to stay fat?
It's a personal preference. We care for everybody to do what he wishes.
Thank you. Well, number three, do you think being fat is healthy?
It is in some cases, and it is not in some cases.
Well, I mean, maybe if you're thin, you have jangled nerves, but if you're too fat, you get heart trouble. So what's the better?
Some people have heart trouble, and some people don't have heart trouble.
Well, that's true enough. Now, number one, in the Arab countries and the Eastern European countries, it might be good to be fat, but that's because it's an economic accomplishment, because they don't have enough to eat. So, I mean, I don't think that's such a great thing to do. I mean, in New York, we've got plenty to eat. It's nice to be thin.
Well, we
have a question and answer it.
I think what you're saying is we feel that fat people are indirectly discriminated against.
Oh, I don't discriminate against them. Sales girls do.
You mentioned economic accomplishment, Peggy. Mark, you take up from there.
Thank you. Number two, is it all right to use the word fat? I assume that since that doesn't insult anybody.
No.
Have you always liked fat girls?
Yes, I have.
Number one, have you always liked them?
Crazy about them.
Back in school?
Oh, yes.
Number three, where did you meet your wife?
At Ithaca College.
Was she heavy then, or did you fatten her up?
No, she was the same weight then.
I see. Number two, why do you think that we have such a cult or an ideal of thin women here? Somebody once said you can never be too thin or too rich. Now, why do you think we feel that way about thinness?
Historically, I don't know. It's just, I guess we're trying to be different from the European point of view.
Kitty Carlisle.
Well, number three, you said that fat people were discriminated against. In what way?
Well, I didn't say it, but it's true.
In what way?
They have trouble getting jobs, and they
really?
Have social problems. Oh, yes, certainly.
Oh, thank you. Number two, I'm sorry. number two, is there any criteria in your club or association for what is fat?
No, it's once again, it's a personal point of view. If a person feels as though he's fat, he's fat.
Oh, no matter what he weighs. I get it. Now, number one, we've all lived on the feeling that moderation is the most important thing in life. Don't you think that too fat or too thin is wrong?
Well, it's not a question of moderation that we actually believe that people's natural body weight sometimes can be attributed as being fat, not necessarily.
Do you think, number two, not to be personal, that...
Derwood Kirby.
Thank you. Number one, do you believe that they, in the saying that they're inside of every fat person, there's a thin person trying to get out?
Well, I've met a great number of fat people, including my wife, that I feel is their natural personality. I think their body weight is according to their personality.
I'm somewhat in accord with your organization because I kind of like fat women myself because I think it's much easier to locate them in the dark. But...
Good point.
Would you say that all fat people are happy people?
No, not all of them are happy. Some of them are happy, but they live in a society that makes it hard to be happy.
Number two, is your wife happy?
Yes.
She looks
there
happy.
You are. I'm going to tell your wife what you said, too, Derwin. She would be very happy to hear that. All right, panel, it's time for you to mark your ballots. Vote number one, number two, or number three. Just write them down there and do the best you can. $50 for all wrong answers. And if you all blow it, if it's a wipeout, $500 goes to our panel. Let me see. We'll start with Peggy.
Well, I don't think it's number one. Mm. Number three is very aggrieved about the problem of fat people, as well he might be. But, you know, number two looks so happy. And if he's that happy to be married to somebody who's a little plump, he'd have that big smile on his face. So I voted for him.
Okay.
See, he's grinning right now.
Mark?
They all could... They all did a beautiful job. To me... number three, who is slightly paler and I think was a thin child, always wanted to compensate for it by having a fat wife. So I voted for number three.
Excellent reasoning, Your Highness.
I voted for number three for two reasons. One, he looks very concerned about the problems of fat people, as well he might be. And when Mrs. Fabry went off, I thought she gave him a very specially kind look.
All right.
Loving look.
Thank you, Kitty. Durward, it's up to you. Last vote.
Thank you, Bill. I go along somewhat with the reasoning that Kitty just gave, but I felt that number three gave some excellent answers, as did number two. However, when it came to Mrs. Fabre kissing number three, he looked so embarrassed, and number one looked like he was so accustomed to this, so that I voted for number one.
Uh-huh. Well, let's see. Well, they're spread out pretty good. One for one, one for two, and two for three. Okay, panel, the votes are all in now. It's time to find out which of these fine fellas is really Bill Fabre. And who better to pick out Bill Fabre, of course, than the lady who introduced all three of them in the first place, Mrs. Fabre. So if you'll please come back out, ma'am, and show us, there you are, which one of those is it. You never can tell the very end here. Yes? Let me see. Is it? Oh. Pretty good. Let's take care and find out who our imposters are. Number one, sir, who are you, please, and what do you do?
I'm Warren McGoldrick. I'm a tennis pro and instructor in management training for the Chase Manhattan Bank.
And thank you. Got a vote. Number two.
My name is Hank Rose, and I run the New York Flea Market.
Say, Bill and Joyce, where is your organization located?
It's in Westbury, New York, at box 745.
Uh-huh. What do you think is the greatest single problem a fat person has to face, Joyce?
Well, it's really personal. Sometimes the social problem is the greatest, and frequently it's the clothing problem that's greater.
Uh-huh. Thank you very much, Mr. and Mrs. Fabre, and imposters for playing to tell the truth. Okay, by way of introducing our next guest, I'd like to show you a picture of half of her. Here you are. Now, all you tennis buffs will, I'm sure, tennis buffs and lingerie fanciers will recognize those panties as belonging to Gussie Moran. Happily, we'll meet all of Gussie in a moment after a few nicely laced messages. As we used to say at South High School at 10th and Carson Street, let's meet our chick style setter.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Gussie Moran.
Number two.
My name is Gussie Moran.
Number three.
My name is Gussie Moran.
Okay, let me do some reading for you now. I, Gussie Moran, love to bring style to the tennis court. Although I was the fourth ranking women's player in the country and have won the women's indoor and hardcore tennis championships, people undeniably remember me best for my tennis skirt with matching lace panties. Currently, I'm helping to introduce some new tennis fashions. They are equally eye-catching, if not controversial. They're called tennis girl dresses, styled by the famous designer Olga. Number three is in top form in a squared neck bodice dress, which features a long waistline accented with red, white, and blue buttons. Number two is decked out in the smart sailor style dress. It has twin pleated skirt, relaxed waistline, and a smart sailor type collar with navy trim and tie. Number one also wears the squared neck tennis girl dress, which affords the wearer a new braless freedom, as well as providing a flattering look. Tennis, anyone? Signed, Gussie Moran. Okay, all three of these pretty girls claim to be Gussie Moran. We will start the questioning with a man who's had a great racket for a long time. Mark? Take it away.
I don't know too much about tennis. Let's see if I know anything about lace panties. Gussie number two, when did you begin this? Let's go back in history. When did you start the business of wearing lace panties?
49 in Wimbledon.
49?
Mm-hmm.
You don't look that old. Number one, why did you start? Why lace panties?
Teddy Tingling designed my tennis dress and forgot the pants.
I didn't hear you.
Teddy Tingling designed my tennis dress and forgot the pants. It was a last-minute makeup.
So what did you do instead? Forgot the pants?
Yes.
So what did you do instead?
He designed pants in a day and put a half-inch lace around the legs.
Number three, how long did you continue to wear lace panties in your tennis?
Oh, all of my life.
Really? Why did you continue with that idea? What was so titillating about lace panties?
I dig them.
You dig them?
So does Mark. Okay, Kitty, can you get us out of panties and into tennis?
No, it fascinates me. Well, I'll try. It's very hard to concentrate on anything except the lace on the pants. Number three, I'll have to ask you one question. Did you know when you wore these lace panties at Wimbledon that it was going to create such a tremendous furore?
No.
Number two, do you know who Suzanne Langlois was?
Yes, she was a very famous tennis player.
Number one, is Olga the lady that makes the lingerie that you're designing for
yes.
now? And number three, how much do your tennis dresses sell for?
Well, they're about the same price as any tennis dress, $35. And I believe this is a $30 model.
Number two, do you still play tennis?
Oh, yes.
Where?
In California.
Oh, you live in California?
Yes.
And number three, are you married?
I'm number three.
I'm sorry, I'm looking at number one. I'm so concerned about the pants. I want to ask you, are you wearing lace pants now?
Not at the moment, I'm not married.
And are you wearing lace pants?
Yes, who'd you ask that of? One? Yeah, answer that, please.
No, I'm not wearing lace pants.
Not wearing them. Behind every tennis player, there's an Olga and a baseline official. Durward?
I'll get away from your pants for a while, but then we'll get back to it. Number one, I have been told that you're a very tall girl, aren't you? How tall are you?
5'7½".
Which is rather tall, right?
Yes.
And that is a big asset in playing tennis?
Definitely for my serve.
Mm-hmm. And number two, you're not quite that tall.
5'3".
And how about your serve?
No problems at all.
And number three?
I'm 5'8".
Number two, Bill mentioned that you were wearing a sailor-type costume, and I noticed that you have quite a long tie. In playing the game, doesn't that tie get in the way of your racket?
Not at all.
No.
No.
Do you remove the tie?
No, never. So attractive was you.
Okay, Durward, Peggy.
Thank you. Number three, a lady tennis player recently said that the purses for ladies in tennis weren't big enough. Who is that?
Billie Jean Moffat King.
Thank you. Number one, when are the what time of the year does Wimbledon held, the Wimbledon Championships?
Just a couple of months prior to Forest Hills. A month prior.
Well, I mean, like what month?
August.
Thank you. And number three, when is Forest Hills?
Right now.
Thank you. And number two, how were you seeded at Wimbledon?
Pardon me?
How were you seeded? What number?
Number five.
You were seeded fifth?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And number three, who was the first lady tennis player that wore a big thing around her head, like the hippies wear?
I think you mean Suzanne Langlois, but it wasn't a hippie look. It was more of a bandeau effect.
Thank you. Number two, at Longwood Cricket Club, what kind of courts do they have?
Clay.
Thank you.
Pretty good. Peggy, you know your tennis. Okay, the votes are in. Panel, mark your ballots for number one, number two, or number three. Here, Mark, I see that you're ready to move.
Bill, I think that I have a feeling that I've met Gussie Moran many years ago. I know I've seen her play tennis. I remember her lace panties very well. And so therefore, I think that just on the chance that I have picked her, I'm going to disqualify myself.
I have a feeling you might have too, and I think I know where it might have been. Kitty.
Well, they all are marvelous. Peggy's questions were very searching, and they certainly knew their tennis. But I voted for number two. I liked the way she stood, and I liked the way she answered, and I liked her smile.
Thank you, Kitty. Durward?
I'm inclined to go along with number one. However, from all I've read about this great professional, I think that she was rather undersized, and therefore was quite adept at the game, and therefore I voted for number two.
And Peggy.
I goofed. It wasn't Billie Jean King who said that. Number three was Rosemary Casals.
I knew that.
And Longwood has grass courts.
And
I think I voted for three. I voted for three, but I guess it's two.
Okay, what do we have? We have two for two, one for three, and Mark generously.
Wouldn't it be funny if I disqualified myself for the wrong person, too?
It's happened.
Well, I've been on the show as a panelist for about a year, and I've done it a couple of times, Mark. So there, even the great ones do it. Don't let it worry you. Will the real Gussie Moran please stand up? There she is. You right? Yeah. Thank you, Gussie. Number one, would you tell us who you are and what do you do, please?
My name is Geoffrey Boyd, and I design computerized typesetting.
Number two?
My name is Dolores Meehan, and I'm a housewife and mother from Manhasset, and I never played tennis in my life.
Well, you did well. You did well. You did very well. Hey, Gussie, in addition to representing Olga, are you anyone else's representative at the moment?
Well, yes, I am. I work for Eastman Chemical in the Codel division, and I also am a representative for Seamless Racket.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't mean they have no seams. I mean, that's the trade name.
You know, I've known you for a long time. What is Gussie? What's your real first name?
Well, Gussie comes from Augusta, my middle name.
Uh-huh.
My first name is Gertrude.
Gertrude? I'd rather see Gussie than Gertie wearing lace panties. Thank you, Gertie, Gussie, and our imposters for playing To Tell the Truth. Hey, thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Marvelous job, oh boy.
Oh, really?
Excellent.
Remember that, sir, when race time comes around. No, thanks, Mark. Derwood, you've been a great help.
I think they ought to give somebody else a chance.
Yeah, I do, too.
Now the women.
Now
the women.
Ladies and gentlemen, this economic discussion will continue tomorrow. Thank you and goodbye from whatever it is.